Can you start by telling us just a little bit about The Seasoning House, what's it all about?
It's about a young girl called Angel, who's deaf, who is kidnapped and forced to work in a brothel and look after the girls. And she looks after them until one day a girl comes that she suddenly connects with, because she becomes very institutionalised being in this brothel having to look after the girls. And she finds this girl she connects with, and everything kind of takes a twist there. And I think that's all I can say, but that's, yeah. And it becomes a bit of an action kind of horror film. So
it's been described as Die Hard meets Pan's Labyrinth. What was it that particularly appealed to you about the project personally?
Really, it was the character of Angel. She's such an unusual kind of character to get to play at such a kind of young age, being a teenager and everything. But it was her. She's such an interesting character, so I really enjoyed playing it. Really difficult, but really great.
Difficult's the right word. It's clearly a challenging role. How did you go about preparing for the part?
I did a lot of research, because obviously it's based on a true story of a girl that actually was deaf and went through these horrific circumstances. So I read up on her and other horrific case stories. So I did all the research I thought was necessary, and I took what I needed. And plus, me and Paul sat down and worked out who Angel was, and at each stage of the film why kind of she was emotionally, which was really, really useful, because she goes through a complete roller coaster. So, yeah.
It's obviously important when you're taking on a challenging role to have support from a good director and a good cast. Can you talk a little bit about some of the people you've been working with on this one?
Yes, Paul Hyatt, our director, is amazing. First-time director, and I would have never, ever known if he hadn't told me. He's been so brilliant, a really collaborative process, really lovely, and the other cast have been great. Working with Sean Pertwee has been like a dream come true. He's so amazing and gives it every take you do. He just gives it his all, and so I've learned so much from working with, I think, everybody. It was a real team like effort, so yeah.
So you've learned a lot. What do you feel you've particularly learned from people like Sean?
I think watching to really go for it kind of on every take, and to know when you're going to scene exactly what you're going to do, and yeah, to really give it your all on every take, regardless what's kind of going on around you, just to focus and yeah, do your best. That's,
I mean, you've obviously taken a lot away from the project yourself. What do you think fans are going to take away from the final film?
I hope they like it as a kind of horror action film, but at the end of the day, there's a hugely strong message about, you know, situations that are happening not just in Eastern Europe but in our country and all over the world, of these places where girls are prostituted, young girls as young as 12, and I hope we haven't glamorized it, and I hope, you know, they take a message that we can't just sweep this under the carpet, because nobody really wants to talk about child prostitution, but I hope from this that they kind of see it for what it is, because it's not glamorized, it is what it is, and I hope they realize that this is on your doorstep, like it doesn't just happen in Eastern Europe, it's happening in our country as well. And yeah, I hope they take that away from it, as well as thinking it's a good film, hopefully.
And in general, are you a big fan of the horror genre, and why do you think people love it so much?
I have never watched a horror film until I got The Seasoning House, and Paul gave me 5 movies to watch over Christmas, so I sat and watched Martyrs, Frontiers, kind of really graphic horror films, and learned a lot about the genre that way. But I think it appeals because it's so exciting, and I really like them now. I've really got into them, and I love the tension. And I haven't seen The Seasoning House yet, but there's a lot of tension and build up, and I like that kind of angst and being absorbed into a film. And I think horror films are really great for that.
Final question, what are you working on next? Do you know what you're going on to?
I've literally just finished 3 months filming in Manchester a new ITV drama series called Homefront, which is out this autumn on ITV1.
Tell us anything about that.
Yeah, it stars Claire Skinner and Greg Wise, and it's about 3 military wives and their lives at home while their husbands are fighting the war in Afghanistan.
Who are you playing it?
I play Millie Bartham, who is the daughter of the lead, a very rebellious character. And yeah, it'll be on September this year.
We look forward to seeing that. We look forward to watching the film tonight. Before you leave us, do you have a message to fans? Anything you'd like to say to them?
No, I just really hope they enjoy the film and they take a message away from it. And we all work really hard on it, and yeah, I hope they like it.
I play Angel's mother. I'm really there to show the audience what Angel has come from. Her relationship with her mother is a very loving one. So that's what she loses when she gets taken to The Seasoning House. And I think that's very important for the audience to have empathy, really, to know what she's come from. Not that it's bad enough just being dragged out of your home, but it makes it worse when you have a happy family, you know. I trusted Paul implicitly. I know him well, and I knew that he was going to handle it in a very delicate and sensitive way. I felt very strongly it was such an important subject to talk about. And I feel in a way this is the best way to do it, because it takes it very seriously, but at the same time it adds an element of fantasy in that this one little girl finds her revenge and comes out of it, and you sort of think, you hope that that is something that might happen. I think it's very unlikely, sadly, but it leaves you with a feeling of maybe girls can get the better of these horrendous brutes of disgusting men.
The film has been joyously described as a mix between Die Hard and Pan's Labyrinth. Do you think that's a fair description, and how would you describe the film overall?
That's amazing. I need to think about that for a minute. I don't know what I think about that. But I guess it's a compliment. I mean, Pan's Labyrinth is the most incredible film. Yeah, I think it's, you know, what I think's great about it is it's horror in the most sort of base form, but it also is telling a very important story. So it's not just this sort of empty horror film. It's very, very important, and I think that's what's so amazing about it having been chosen to be the opening film at the festival. It shows how horror has evolved and how important it is as a genre.
We're here at Fright Fest celebrating the horror genre. What do you think it gives audiences that they don't get from other genres? Why do people love it so much?
I think it's a lot of it's to do with escapism from your own life. It's a way of, in a cynical way, I think it's because it maybe makes you feel slightly better about your own life. I think we all like to be thrilled. It's a bit like going on a roller coaster. It's thrilling, makes you feel alive. You come out, you feel revitalized and, you know, maybe kind of good because you've survived it. So I think it's a lot of things.
I mean, is there a particular horror film that you're passionate about that you love?
I thought it might come onto this. I'm going to have to admit here that I find horror difficult. I'm a bit of a wimp, I have to be honest. I like being in them. I'm not great at watching them, to be honest. I'm a wimp.
I play Alexa. And she is married to one of the soldiers, and Angel comes across her cottage in the middle of the woods after she escapes the brothel, and you think that everything's okay. She takes her in and, you know, sews up her wounds, cleans her, and then suddenly it all goes wrong. I won't tell you any. Have you seen it?
We're watching it tonight, so we're very excited.
Okay. Yeah, I don't want to give too much away, but yeah, I get quite violent. Yeah.
I mean, it is a violent film and it deals with some very difficult real life material. What do you think audiences are going to take away from all of that?
Well, I hope that they take away that, you know, apart from it being a great film and, you know, a wonderful horror film, that, you know, there is a very strong message in there. And it wasn't so long, it's loosely based, you know, during the Balkan War. It wasn't so long ago. And I think people forget that and, you know, what went on. And I've got a Serbian friend and a Croatian friend that lived through it. And, you know, they have to take medication for, you know, just remembering it. It was just so brutal and terrific.
I mean, how did you prepare for your involvement in the film?
How did I prepare?
Yeah, I mean, obviously you mentioned you've had friends who've had similar real-life experience. Did you talk to them? And, I mean, what kind of research did
you
do?
Yeah, I spoke to them. And also I had to have, you know, obviously a dialect coach and also stunt training, fight training. And I did a lot of reading, you know. I didn't really know much about it, so it was interesting reading about it. And I watched, have you seen The Whistleblower as well?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I saw that. And it's just something that I don't really, you know, I didn't know that much about. So it was really great to be able to kind of learn about, yeah.
Obviously working with a very exciting young actress in Rosie. Can you talk a little bit about how blown away you were by her performance?
Oh, she was just amazing. So young and just so professional and focused, and it's always such a pleasure working with actors who she just gave so much, and yeah, it was just a real pleasure working with her, yeah.
And with Paul as a debut director, what was that like?
Yeah, it was a real honour to work with him. Yeah, a real honour. He was very calm, which is always nice. It's always nice as an actor to have a calm director who's very clear about what they want, and he had a very strong artistic vision, so that's always a relief because it's quite scary entering a project when you don't trust people around you, so yeah.
Can you tell us just a little bit, first of all, about your role in The Seasoning House?
Yeah, I play this character called Victor. He's a Bosnian war criminal, basically, on the run. And the way he's keeping himself in the shadows is he runs this house and it's basically the sex slave trade industry. All these young girls, whenever these villages get brutalized and the girls get kidnapped, the military bring them in to me, I pay them, they bring these girls in, I get them put on heroin and smacked up, and then all the guys come in and use them for money. And it's basically like a rape, not a rape camp, but you could say that, but it's a very brutal brothel, really, yeah. So not very nice.
Clearly, I think the most shocking part is that the film is based to some extent at least on real life events. Yeah, do you think exactly. That adds an extra dimension to this kind of horror?
I hope so, but not in a titillating way. And I stress that because that was the one thing that we were very adamant about. When Sean and I first went to the script meeting and we sat together and we said, it's the one thing that we were really adamant about, that we didn't want this subject matter being sort of cheated into some cheap titillation and thrills, like vicarious thrills for people, because it's something that is going on out there, you know, and I've studied it a lot. And, you know, I looking at the Helen Bamber Institute and the things that she's trying to do to stop all this going on. It goes on in this country. I mean, it's pretty awful. And it's weird. There seems to be some weird zeitgeist about it at the moment as well, because Silent Witness the other night I happened to watch, and that was all about a similar thing about kids, these young Indian lads, you know, getting these young girls on drugs and getting them locked up in houses and everything. So it was like really weird watching that, like 2 or 3 days before coming here to do this. So very strange, yeah.
I think clearly the film's going to have an impact on audiences. Did it affect you emotionally being involved in the production?
Well, I hope it has an impact on audiences in the right way. Did it affect me? What, just playing the role? No, that's what I do. It's your homework. That's what you study to do. That's what I do. That's what I study, the character. You get in depth with it. You go for it. And you've got to love what you do. So, you know, those moments when it seems like you're loving the character you're playing, well, you are. And you're getting involved in that. But you leave it behind. You go home, you leave it behind. So it's just it's a character. This life is out there and it has to be portrayed. So someone has to do it. So, yeah, this time it was me.
See, we're here at Fright Fest celebrating the horror genre. Why do you think people love it so much, and what do you think they get from it that they maybe don't from rom-com, sci-fi?
I think there's a lot of films that are very edgy, and obviously there's a massive horror fan base with Fright Fest. And it's kind of ironic, because even though there are a lot of horrible films horrible things that happen in The Seasoning House, I personally wouldn't class it as a horror movie as such. But I would probably describe it more harrowing than horror. So, but I think, well, I mean, what a fantastic turnout. I mean, a Thursday evening in the middle of the summer holidays when most people are away, I think it's brilliant. Fantastic.
First of all, how does it feel to be opening Fright Fest?
Oh, absolutely brilliant. It's when I heard about it, I was so ecstatic. It's a perfect place, I think, for the film. And a complete honour.
Sean, it's always great to see you. Can you tell us what it was that appealed to you about this project and a little bit about your character for fans who haven't seen it?
The most importantly was just working with Paul and also the script, because it was a very difficult script, and there were elements that I was very wary of that I didn't want it to digress to. And knowing and having worked with Paul 7, 8 or 9 times before, I knew that we would have a discussion. It wouldn't sort of err towards torture porn. It treads a very tenuous line between reality and heightened reality and the viciousness of the human spirit. And it's not glib. And we're very proud of it, because it isn't. I've seen it now, and it's an extraordinarily difficult film. And the character of Goran, he's not just a generic bad man. He's a thug who tries to reinvent himself but reverts to type. You can't take the tiger out the tiger. And I like that about that element.
And as Sean mentioned, it's obviously a very challenging script that tackles some very hard real-life issues. Can you talk about what motivated you to bring that story to the big screen?
It's a fascinating subject, and it's a subject a lot of people don't really know about. By doing the research, it's amazing how much this happens in Europe, in England, you know, sex slavery, sex trafficking, taking girls and sexualizing them and turning them into a commodity. And on such a grand scale, wherever there's civil wars, girls are displaced, they're sold, trafficked, and not much is known about this subject. And when you dig deep, it's amazing on a scale how much it happens. So I thought, what an interesting subject to tackle.
I think it was very important to get a young girl capable of playing this very demanding role. I mean, Sean, can you talk a little bit about how impressed you were by Rosie's performance?
I'm not just impressed with her physically, but by her sort of acting acumen. I mean, the thing is, it's extraordinary how she portrays a prisoner within a prison, because she's a deaf mute. She's incarcerated in basically this detritus and hell. And she has this ability to completely shut off. And it's extraordinary, and this is why the other character, Victor, the other sort of evil protagonist in many respects, warms to her, because she's, it appears, unaffected by this horrendous behaviour that is happening within these walls, which basically becomes her reality. And she could turn it on and turn it off. It was extraordinary. But not only what she put her little body through was, I have nothing but respect for. I mean, she was, like I was saying earlier on, she was cut to ribbons, black and blue. I mean, you often hear about actors doing their own stunts and bish, bosh, bish. But she did do, she gets through a gap this big. I mean, I've seen her do it. And I thought this was makeup all over her, and it was actually her. And I, you know, I've got nothing but respect for her. She's an extraordinary talent, one to really watch.
I mean, we're here at Fright Fest, which is a horror film festival. I guess the obvious question, what do you think fans get from the horror genre that they don't from others? And do you feel that that's a label that accurately applies to The Seasoning House?
Yeah, it's an experience, you know? It's something that you go through. And I think some films you watch, some films you experience and survive. And I'm hoping The Seasoning House takes people on that roller coaster, makes them think about the subject, and takes them through an experience and a journey.
What's up next for both of you? Sean, you're a very busy man always. What have you got coming up after this?
I'm actually working with the great Jean Reno at the moment, with the lady that directed The Killing and The Bridge in Paris. So that's a right result, really. And then I'll be working with Paul very soon, won't I?
Yeah,
won't I, Paul?
Definitely.
Well, I mean, obviously this is your debut as a director. Do you know what you're going to go on to next?
Basically, Seasoning House is part one of a war-themed horror trilogy. So may continue there, or there's other projects I'm looking at. So let's see.